This is in continuation with the previous video where I summarized the qualities that make a good PhD supervisor. This is the most detailed part yet, where I will be diving into the methodology of identifying the right PhD guide. After doing an in-depth study of this topic, as mentioned in the beginning of part 3, I have identified the following 10 most important points towards making the right choice. The first and most emphasized point I found is to take your time. Don't jump. It is better to be safe than sorry. Remember that the very purpose of your higher education so far has been to empower you to make well-informed decisions, and be rest assured that your institution is well-equipped to address any concerns. Second, think. This shouldn't come as a surprise, especially since you are planning to make this your job description for the next few years. It is advised to be diligent and meticulous in your decision making in order to foresee as many possible future hurdles as possible. See if any reservations or hesitations can be addressed prior to joining in order to avoid future setbacks. Remember, precaution is better than cure. Third, type of project. Advertised projects with a broad outline of the aim are common in the STEM fields, that is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Self-proposed projects are the norm in arts, humanities, and social sciences. Professional doctorates are common in areas of business and management. Next, do some background research of the broad research area of your choice, and if possible, also gauge the interest of the extended research community at large in the topic. Fourth, peripheral concerns. It is only after addressing concerns like accommodation, daily commute, quality of social life, ability to stay in touch with friends and family, and other possible priorities that one is free to completely drain the mind of distractions and concentrate on work. An uncluttered mind is crucial for productivity. Fifth, potential supervisors. Interact with them. How do they connect with you professionally and personally? Which projects and other activities do they have on their hands? Having to shoulder multiple responsibilities could enhance their resourcefulness, but at the cost of the time they can spend in mentoring you. What stage of their career are they in? Senior professors could have higher funding and resources, and also invaluable experience in keeping the students' PhDs on track and pacing their progress. On the other hand, the junior ones can spend more time in understanding and aligning with the students' priorities. As a blank slate, they are less likely to expect you to fill into the shoes of some of their previous exceptional students. Weigh your priorities and see what seems right for you as a research scholar. Do remember that no mentor can be perfect. What matters is what works best for you. Note that this fifth point can be helpful only to those who know themselves very well. Sixth, research environment. See if the institute can provide you the access to necessary journals, equipment, software, and resources concerning your specific area of research. See which softwares and programming languages you will be requiring, and whether there are any tutorials or handy resources that can be used to learn them. Along with the supervisor, who will have the single most upper hand in guiding your research, you may also like to give a thought to his collaborators, who could possibly be present in your advisory committee, the postdoctoral fellows, whose previous experience can provide a major boost, other graduate students, who have experience of being mentored by the same person, and have more clarity about their expectations from their students. Seventh, the degree of integration of the research group. See whether the team boasts of a set of capable, independent workers who are strong one-person armies, or has a cohesive collaborative environment for learning together, bouncing ideas off each other, and develop understanding through scientific discussions. Also try to find out the research centers on the global level that work in your related areas. This could be instrumental in guessing where you might be required to be traveling to for attending global conferences, training schools, workshops, and pursuing future opportunities. Eighth, size of the research team. Large teams might indicate higher availability of funding and resources, and thus fertile projects with more opportunities and good future prospects, but could get easily saturated as well. Smaller teams might mean non-mainstream projects, but would also make your topic exclusive and allow for a higher share of your mentor's net time availability. Practicality is also as important as passion. More important, in fact, since scholars were found to start losing interest in their topic after a 3-month period. Ask questions like, does your topic have the right scope for a PhD? Is it feasible to carry out the proposed work within the stipulated time period? What is its difficulty level? On an average, what is the minimum time required to be dedicated by you on a daily basis for timely completion? Are the objectives of the topic clear? Who in the research team can help you along the way, say in the acquisition of the requisite skills? When you have a PhD at stake, taking on overambitious projects was found to be strongly advised against. Last but not the least, first-hand experience. Actually working on a project can be a real eye-opener. Your expectation of the project and the project's expectation from you could differ severely. Move further than reading popular science articles or attending colloquia. Try reading a research paper on the topic and notice if you see yourself reading such material every day for the next few years. Work satisfaction on a routine basis is key to finishing a PhD with the same enthusiasm as you started it. The destination of a doctorate degree can be reached only after a long, arduous journey, and often after reaching the destination, one realizes that the true destination had been the journey itself. So those were the top 10 criteria for choosing the right PhD supervisor. However, I also came across a way of how not to choose the supervisor. I will discuss it without fail here, since it is counterintuitive and dispels the simple notion that seeking celebrated professors ensures high work satisfaction in graduate research. Here it goes. Looking at academic credentials. In an article titled, What Matters in a PhD Advisor? Here's what the research says. Katie Langin, Associate Editor of Science Careers, writes that compromising the supportiveness and other qualities for seeking well-known advisors who are highly reputed in their fields is hardly an effective strategy in the long run. Supportiveness in a personal way was found to contribute more towards organic professional development of the student rather than having a stalwart who's aloof. While it is true that a reference from an eminent scientist could get you accepted in elite programs, it was found to be completely uncorrelated with the student's employability as a scientist in the longer run. On the other hand, a less supportive advisor, eminent or not, paves the way for having a miserable time during your formative ages as a budding researcher, adversely affecting the very enthusiasm with which you approach your work. The two common mistakes students make are, firstly, looking at the resume. While it is a record of the guide's accomplishments and by extension a testament to their excellent competency as an individual scientist, it promises nothing about their ability and or keen interest in mentoring and providing guidance to others so as to help them excel too. Secondly, glancing at their past research papers. As a list of projects that they have previously completed in the past, this does provide a closer look of their work, but may not provide any information regarding the scientist's current activities and interests, which are bound to evolve with time. It can help, however, in showcasing how many publications they have had with their previous research scholars and where the student's name appears in the list of authors. So now I have completely covered all that I have found about how to and even on how not to choose a PhD advisor. Thank you.